On October 7th morning in 2025, the telephone rang in John Martinis's home in Santa Barbara, California. The voice on the other end of the line spoke with a Swedish accent. It was the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences, calling to inform him that he, along with his former mentor John Clarke and colleague Michel Devoret, had won the Nobel Prize in Physics. The world's highest honor in science was being awarded, the caller explained, for their discovery of macroscopic quantum mechanical tunneling and energy quantization in an electric circuit. For Martinis, a man whose entire professional life had been a determined march toward a single monumental goal, the news was a validation of a journey that began four decades earlier. The prize was not for his recent, more famous achievements. It was for a series of experiments he conducted as a graduate student at the University of California, Berkeley in 1984 and 1985. Back then, a quantum computer was pretty much just a theory. Yet in a low-temperature laboratory, this trio of physicists had built a small electronic circuit, a device you could hold in your hand, and coaxed it into obeying the strange and delicate laws of the quantum world. They had shown that an object built by human hands, containing billions of particles, could behave as a single quantum entity. That breakthrough laid the foundation for an entire field. Martinis' early work on superconducting circuits laid the groundwork for the powerful quantum computers that big tech is now building. The 40-year gap between the experiment and the prize is quite a story. It's about a man who had this big, bold idea early on and then spent the next four decades incredibly focused, turning that breakthrough lab experiment into something that could transform our world. Back in the mid-80s, Berkeley's campus was a happening place for physics, but quantum computers were just a crazy idea that a few bold theorists were scribbling on chalkboards. John Martinis was a graduate student then, a young man who was drawn not just to the abstract beauty of physics, but to the tangible craft of building things. He was, as a colleague would later describe him, the engineer among physicists. He was restless, practical, and more likely to be found adjusting cables than debating wave functions. One day, he attended a lecture by the celebrated physicist Richard Feynman. Feynman, with his characteristic flair, spoke of a new kind of computer, one that would operate not on the familiar logic of ones and zeros, but on the peculiar rules of quantum mechanics. He imagined a machine that could use the properties of individual atoms and particles to perform calculations far beyond the reach of any conventional computer. For Martinis, it was a call to action. "It was clear to me that this was a great idea and that it would be wonderful to work on it," he later recalled. That lecture really lit a fire for Martinis, giving him a grand goal. While everyone else was busy talking about what could be, he saw a machine just waiting to be built. His PhD work was groundbreaking, showing how quantum states worked in superconductors, the same stuff he'd use for his entire career. Feynman laid out the big picture, and Martinis was going to be the one to make it happen. His whole career wasn't just about figuring out the quantum world, but actually building a machine that could control it. To get what Martinis and his team achieved, you need to start with the basic difference between a regular computer and a quantum one. A classical computer thinks in bits. A bit is like a light switch. It can be either on, represented by a one, or off, represented by a zero. There is no in-between. All the complex operations of a modern computer boil down to manipulating billions of these simple, definite states. A quantum computer uses another kind of bit, a qubit. A qubit is not a simple switch. It is more like a spinning coin. While it is in the air, it is neither heads nor tails. It is in a blended state of both possibilities at once. This property, called superposition, allows a qubit to hold a value of both 1 and 0 simultaneously. This ability to exist in multiple states at once is what gives a quantum computer its extraordinary power. 2 qubits can hold 4 values at once. 3 qubits can hold 8. The power grows exponentially. With just a few dozen qubits, you can represent more numbers than there are atoms in the universe. The challenge in the 1980s was how to build a physical qubit. To do so, you need a system that has distinct energy levels, like the rungs on a ladder, that can be precisely controlled. Martinis, working under the guidance of John Clarke, chose to build his qubit from a superconducting circuit. At temperatures colder than deep space, certain materials lose all electrical resistance and become superconductors. Electrons flow through them without losing any energy. The heart of their device was a component called a Josephson Junction. It is a deceptively simple thing, just 2 pieces of superconductor, separated by an insulating barrier only a few atoms thick. In the classical world, this barrier would be a dead end for electricity. But in the quantum world, pairs of electrons can perform a trick called tunneling. They can pass directly through the barrier as if it were not there. This junction acts as a special circuit component, creating the distinct ladder-like energy levels needed to form a qubit. The Berkeley team's great achievement was to build a circuit with a Josephson junction that was large enough to see, a macroscopic object. They then demonstrated that this entire circuit, containing billions of electrons, acted like a single quantum particle. It showed that it could tunnel from one energy state to another, and that its energy levels were quantized, meaning it could only absorb or release energy in discrete packets. Before this, quantum effects were thought to be the exclusive domain of natural microscopic particles like atoms. This experiment proved that a human-made object could be engineered to obey quantum laws. It made the idea of a quantum machine physically real. Their breakthrough came from an awesome team effort. John Clarke was the steady mentor, super careful and patient with measurements. Michel Devoret, a postdoc from France, was the brains behind the bold ideas. And Martinis, the grad student, was the hands-on builder, constantly tweaking and rebuilding the equipment until it worked. Together, they didn't just see something new. They kicked open the door to a whole new kind of tech. After earning his PhD from Berkeley in 1987, Martinis did not immediately set out to build a quantum computer. The technology was still in its infancy, and the path forward was unclear. He took a postdoctoral position in France, and then joined the National Institute of Standards and Technology, NIST, in Boulder, Colorado. For more than a decade, his work was not on quantum computers directly, but on the fundamental physics of low-temperature devices. He developed highly sensitive X-ray detectors and new electrical standards based on counting individual electrons. It was a time of sharpening his tools. He was mastering the difficult art of building and controlling superconducting circuits, learning to fight against the noise and imperfections that could destroy delicate quantum states. He was methodically solving the thousands of small engineering problems that stood between the idea of a single qubit and a functional machine. In 2004, he moved to the University of California, Santa Barbara, UCSB, and his work turned squarely toward quantum computation. At UCSB, he and his growing team of students began building some of the most reliable qubits in the world. The physics world started to take notice, In 2014, his long, patient work was recognized with the prestigious Fritz London Memorial Prize, an award given for outstanding contributions to low-temperature physics. The prize was a big deal. John Martinis, the quiet innovator from Berkeley, was now leading a field on the brink of a major breakthrough. The London Prize brought Martinis to the attention of the wider tech world. In 2014, Google made an unprecedented move. It hired not just Martinis, but his entire research group from UCSB, bringing them into a new, well-funded lab with a single audacious mission: to build a quantum computer that could do something no classical computer could. The whole point was to hit quantum supremacy. Now, that doesn't mean a quantum computer that can solve any useful problem. It's actually a more specific and symbolic big deal: doing a super specific calculation that's definitely out of reach for even the world's beefiest supercomputer. Think of it like the Wright Flyer moment for quantum computing, proving that this new kind of computation is genuinely possible. For 5 years, Martinis' team worked with an intense focus. The culmination of their effort was a processor named Sycamore, a chip containing 54 qubits arranged in a two-dimensional grid. In 2019, they were ready for the test. They programmed the Sycamore chip to execute a sequence of random operations. For a quantum computer, this task is straightforward. For a classical computer, the difficulty of simulating it grows exponentially with each added qubit. The result was historic. The Sycamore processor performed the calculation in just 200 seconds. The team estimated that the same task would have taken the world's fastest supercomputer, IBM's Summit, approximately 10,000 years. This was a huge scientific moment in 2019. In 2021, Martinis got the John Stuart Bell Prize, which is the highest award in quantum mechanics. The award recognized his leadership in devising low-error, multi-qubit superconducting chips, which have resulted in the first plausible claim of quantum supremacy. Just a few months after this huge win, Martinis announced he was leaving Google. He stepped down in April 2020. After the supremacy experiment was complete, Google moved Martinis from his hands-on leadership role into an advisory position. This change led to disagreements with Hartmut Nevin, the longtime head of Google's quantum project. In an interview with Forbes, Martinis later explained the split in his own terms. "It was a matter of research style. My personal research style tends to be very intently focused," he said. He acknowledged that his approach, which had been so effective in driving the team toward the single goal of supremacy, was hard on people, and that tension comes with focus. Martinis did not stay idle for long. After a period in Australia with a startup called Silicon Quantum Computing, where he explored different types of qubit technology, he returned to California to begin the next chapter of his career. In 2022, he started his own company, Qolab. With Qolab, Martinis is tackling the next big challenge in quantum computing: the problem of scale. Building a 53-qubit processor was a huge achievement, but building a million-qubit processor, which is what's needed for a truly useful, fault-tolerant quantum computer, is a whole different ballgame. It's no longer just a physics experiment, it's an industrial engineering challenge. He is pursuing what he calls a system engineering mindset and a collaborative horizontal business model. Instead of trying to invent everything in-house, Qolab aims to partner with the existing semiconductor industry, leveraging its decades of experience in high-precision, large-scale fabrication. To understand John Martinis is to understand the mind of a builder. He is a man for whom the line between life and work has all but disappeared. John's idea of a relaxing Sunday is to go into the lab and solder something together, as per his former colleagues. When asked about his future, Martinis smiled and said, "Physicists like me don't retire. We have lots of things to do." The Nobel Prize he received in 2025 honors a discovery made in the quiet of a university laboratory 40 years ago. But for John Martinis, the work's not done yet. There are always new challenges to tackle.